So I'm from Carnegie Mellon University, and in this talk today, I'm going to talk about our work on predictive synthesis of API sensitive code. So let me actually start this presentation with a short quiz, assuming that everyone here is pretty familiar with TensorFlow PyTorch. Let's imagine a situation where you're asked to write a program in TensorFlow PyTorch that transforms this input tensor into this output tensor. So where would you start? You don't need to answer it out loud, but try to follow this in your head. So some people who are experts in PyTorch or TensorFlow already, they might have known the answer already, but let's assume that we're not. We'll probably then start by guessing what operation we need to use here. So what I think I'll do is to use matrix multiplication on post.memo by looking at the tensor sizes and also by increasing the output. And then what I'll do next is that I'll check the results, either through running it on my computer or just compute the results myself in my head, and check if the intermediate output value matches with the desired output. And then I'll see that it actually doesn't match. And since it does not, I'll further do the guess, the next step again, by repeating what I've done before. So by looking at the positions of the values here, I can now guess that in these transpose, and I'll apply the transpose here to the intermediate output value and check the final desired output matches, and we now have the final program. So it was how we as humans write program given a specification of input and output examples. Now let's look at how a simple program synthesis approach does this answer this question. So given the base values like the input tensors in the specification, or some basic numeric values like 0 or 1 that we can use for the parameter values like axis, and all possible API functions in PyTorch, what it will do is it will try all combinations of the base values and the API functions possible. And that will do it one by one in a brute force way. For example, it will start by trying input 1 and 1 and A in the PyTorch function list, and it will produce this result. And it will check if it matches or not, and then it will try the next one, like this, and next one, and so on. And later on, the outputs from the previous searches will also be used as inputs, so the search space will get even larger and larger when it, as the search goes, and we'll do it until it finds the final desired output. So it is guaranteed to find the answer, find the problem, because it can take, it will try everything until it finds an answer. But of course it could take infinite amount of time, especially when the desired problem is complicated, for example, requiring multiple input functions. So some researchers actually have tried to speed up the search by prioritizing some API functions in that box, using some heuristics or machine learning based on predictions. But it is still not really ideal because it needs to go through all of the API functions or base values until it finds it, and it can easily grow exponentially. So this is not like how we actually program. So we started thinking about a way to actually speed up this search even further, to be more like how we actually write the problem. And we realized that if we can guess the necessary operations one by one, like what we did in the beginning, and only type those API functions in the search, it will save a lot of time. Because we can reduce the search space significantly. So for example, given the input and output values, if we can guess that we'll need that ball for the first API function, then we'll only try running it with some parameter values, the combinations of base values, and then we'll use these intermediate outputs to read the next API function, and we'll find the answer way faster. Or, like people who are experts in PyTorch already, we might be able to guess the full sequence of API functions, by the way, at once. Then we just need to fill in these parameter values with some combination of base values, and that's it. This will reduce a lot of search space. So we thought the sequence guessing part can be done by training a machine learning model. And in this work, we set a goal to build a model, machine learning model, predicting a sequence of API functions, more similar to how we, humans, program. So given test specification, we want to guess the next probable or sequence of API functions. So that's our first contribution to build this ML model. And we also came up with a way to incorporate this computational model into the intermediate search-based synthesis and accelerate the program synthesis of API centric code. In particular, with this goal, we focused on building a model that can predict API functions computationally to mimic how humans write program. In other words, we wanted the model to predict the next API function based on the intermediate value the previous API function. And obviously, we use RNN for this, which is the most simple and intuitive model to use for a sequence prediction. But here, we actually made a one small interesting change to take into account the difference between the natural language and API-centric code, which is to not to pass the previously predicted API function for the next API function prediction. This is because for API-centric code, we need to focus less on the relation between API functions, which is what general RNN is trying to do. Because in the traditional way, the model will predict transpose after that model because they are commonly used together. But it works well in natural language, but not always in API, not always in API-centric program synthesis, because technically any API function can come after another as long as we have the output value. So we wanted to train a model to focus on the semantics of every API function. By semantics, we mean the relation between the input and the output values so that it can compose the API function based on the values. So with this high-level idea, it built two variants on the same model. The first one is called first of sequence mode, where it predicts API functions one by one. So given input tensors, for every next API function. And the final output tensor, the desired output tensor, it predicts the most probable next API function iteratively. And after each API function prediction, we compute the intermediate output value using the predicted API function and use that to predict the next API function. And we have another variant, which is a little bit more advanced, like the PyTorch experts, you can guess the sequence at once. So here we don't provide the intermediate value to the model, but we expect the model to use the information flowing between the RNN cells. So for this one, without additional computations on our end, the model will predict the full sequence at once. And of course, to train this kind of model, we need a lot of data. And here, we're luckier than other people who need to collect a lot of data from the wild, as we can generate the input and output pairs automatically, because we can just run any program. So we generated a data set of 202 unique sequences of API functions, PyTorch API functions, and we need more than 5 million pairs of input and output tensors for training. And as we also wanted to test whether our approach works well in the real-world program, we use the benchmark generated with real-world Stack Overflow test collected by TF Porter authors, TF Porter here is another intermediate synthesis based API-centric code program synthesis. So after filtering out ones that were not that were out of our scope, we ended up with 15 unique sequences of API functions with 18 different test cases. And this was only used to evaluate our model, the machine learning model, and the downstream task of program synthesis. And here is the results we got after the training, the model test accuracy. In general, the model was able to achieve pretty reasonable test accuracy, as you can see. And as we can expect from the design, for subsequent mode did better as it gets more information on the actual values of the intermediate inputs than the full sequence area. But one interesting point here is that although the first of sequences top one accuracy is better for the stack overflow benchmark, at top three they became similar. So we believe that these results indicate that the model actually did learn a representation of the intermediate states of the APL version sequence, meaning that even without passing the true intermediate values, the full sequence mode behaves at par with the first sub-sequence mode. So to check our, whether our hypothesis holds or not, that our model learns to convert its incoming hidden vector to its outgoing hidden vector in a way consistent with the semantics of the APL function, we designed an interesting test here. So here are the two units of compositional model, where the first one predicts that model and produces a hidden vector H1. And the second unit produces hidden vector H2, and it predicts transpose without the concrete intermediate value. So this is the full sequence model there. And the second, and on your right-hand side, here's an alternate situation in which we give the results of that model in one and in two directly to the first unit, which then produces H2 time. So here, if our hypothesis holds, if H1 captures the complete intermediate value after that model, H2 and H2 prime should be similar in the representation space. So we tested that through visualization of H2 and H2 prime, and here is what we got. So here, the green dots mean green dots are H2, and purple dots are H2 prime. And as a comparison, we plotted H1s as well in blue. And as you can see, H2 and H2 prime are close together in the representation space. We actually even ran a statistical test on this and confirmed that the cosine similarities between H2 and H2 prime are significantly lower than H2 and H1, which means that our model actually learns to convert its incoming hidden vector to its outgoing hidden vector in a way consistent with the APL function's semantics. So finally, back to the downstream task, we incorporated the two modes into the synthesis. For the first of sequence mode, we first invoke the first of sequence mode by inputting input transition output, and it produces predicts that model. So we try running it with some combinations of base values, and then we input the output intermediate values into another first of sequence unit, and we'll get the final results. And for the first sequence model, it's even easier. We invoke the full sequence model and get the sequence, and we just need to fill it with final values. So this is the final results we got. This shows the y-axis shows the time it takes, and the blue bars, they are the average time it took for 18 benchmark tests. And I don't know if you can see the white line, but that shows the maximum time it took from the benchmark. And the number in the parentheses shows the number of successful synthesis cases. So here, the compositional model incorporated research could actually save a lot of time, from 10 seconds on average to 1 second. And if you look at the maximum time, it is even the difference is even significant. It could fail some cases where the compositional model failed to predict it, the right sequence as past candidates. But we expect that this time saving will be even more significant when the program gets more complicated or it requires more number of API functions, because it'll reduce a lot of resources. So this ends my presentation. I first introduced why we wanted to train a compositional model, and then I introduced the two modes of our model, and then I showed that our model is actually able to convert its incoming hidden vector to its outgoing hidden vector in a way consistent with the semantics functions. And finally, I show that the compositional model could speed up the synthesis a lot. Thank you so much for your attention, and I'm ready to take your
questions. Do we have time for a question? Yeah, we have a question.
three basic renovations of the dispensers.
Yeah, but when you get the embedding from these sensors, how do you do that?
Oh, how do we encode the sensors?
Yes.
Is that, so we use all of the values, the raw values, and then we encoded the sizes and the types of the values into port encoding. You can read the paper and there will be the port encoding. But we basically use the raw vector, raw numbers. Yes.
Does your algorithm implicitly consider the shape of the output? Because I feel like as human, when we are listening, whether like which operation to use to compute the output, we look at the shape.
Yeah, that's actually a good intuition. So we did an algorithm that we looked at. So we first tried with just the numbers, and then we added the shape information into the encoding, and it actually improved the performance. So we do think that the model learns the semantics of feature functions, and like part of that is like shape is really important.
Great, we can maybe the next speaker can plug in, or you can take, if you want to take a question while he's doing that. Talk of the session is From Perception to Programs, Regularize, Overparameterize, and Amortize, and Hao Tang. Thank you.
Thank you.